All right, guys, we've had a great day on the river today, and now Jim's gonna show us his techniques and some flies and stuff that he's been successful with here.
I don't think you could have had a better day for the weather and everything, and fishing some beautiful water. Thank you.
Well, and I thought it would be fun. Yeah, and I thought it would be a perfect opportunity for us to show you addicts, you know, a great way from someone who's been doing it forever in the Northwest, catching salmon and steelhead on flies. Got Jim Teeny in the boat, so I figured let's get a good tutorial out of Jim Teeny while he's here. So what would you start with as far as rod and reel, you know, if you were getting into the fly fishing?
Well, steelhead and salmon, I think a 9 foot or all the way up to maybe a 10 foot rod, and it could be 8 or 9 weight is a great start, because you can catch chums, coho, steelhead, and kings. You know,
so
it's a little light,
but
you can get, you know, it's a good size. And then you just balance it out with the right lines. And like, for example, this is like a T300. And this works on a 7 all the way up to a 10 weight rod. So an 8 or a 9 is like perfect, you know, for a T300.
And especially here in the Northwest, you know, with all the different species we have with the salmon, the steelhead, coho, all that good stuff, you're going to be able to fish for all varieties
absolutely.
With that line weight.
Yeah, absolutely.
Perfect, you know, perfect.
It's just you balance the line with the rod. And I designed these lines back in 1983.
This is one of your original lines, right?
Yeah, it is. The only thing that we've done now on changes is we put factory welded loops at both ends. And also what I did, and not too many people know I did it, I just did it, where the color change on this line, and I'll show you as we go to cast it, where the color change goes from the dark to the orange, I continued to have that diameter be a little heavier for about 8 feet, and then it tapers down into the shooting line, because that's the balance and the stress point of the line. So that when you're working your line, you're working the color change all the time. It'll roll cast then, or you know, that's where you're really putting the most usage on the lines, is right there.
In that
so
action.
We just made that just a little heavier. Now they're even better.
Right.
You know,
right,
they're even more. I mean, they were already really durable, but now they're even more durable. And that was a minor change, but in a major way.
That's awesome. That's awesome. What about if you know, you're getting new into this, what would you start with for flies? Is there a certain color or water type, or do you have a fly box you can maybe show us the variety that you carry with you on the water?
I do. I'm so armed on the flies. I never want to run out, you know.
That's right.
And let's look in this one, see what's in this one first. I love to tie flies. You know what I mean? I started when I was 12, and I'm still doing it. Look at that.
Look at the color.
One of the things, if you're a fly tier, what we've been doing is using orange thread, makes orange heads, or blue, and those two colors really make the flies stand out a bit. Now, when we do our regular teeny nymphs for trout and things like that, we use white.
Right.
You know, and they look like little chironomids and stuff, and it's perfect. But these are not all set patterns, but they'll all work,
right,
you know, in the right time and place and everything. And I never even went into this box today. Maybe I should.
Yeah. You know? So if it's as far as the flies go, are you know, darker colors more prevalent or work better in lower conditions, or brighter colors, or is it kind of like a bead where sometimes you'll get a super bright color that works on a clear sunny day, you know, something you would never imagine? Is it kind of spread out, or is it like dark colors for clear water and bright colors for murky water, or you kind of just spread it out?
You know, I know that there's some truth to all that, but I've never been that technical.
Right.
I love to change the color and the size of the fly, or I'll change the line, or I'll change the leader, you know, to longer, shorter.
Right.
But, you know, because that's part of, I mean, sometimes I get on it and I'm hooking fish on the fly, I'll take it off and I'll put on another one to see if it'll work.
Right,
and,
sure.
And if it's not, I'll put it back on.
Kind of like us with our spinners and our 360s.
Yeah, I mean, but it's fun to experiment.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Like, you know, when we go to Alaska, we're so dialed in on the sockeyes and the chums. It's just like, and the kings, it's not even guesswork anymore. We know that they like hot pink.
Right. Sure.
And,
sure.
You know, I mean, we know that.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
And chartreuse and, you know, yeah, and all that yeah. stuff. So when you know that, I mean, you go in with that confidence level.
Exactly.
And everything.
And I believe it, all fishing, you know, is a big confidence thing. It's
oh,
like
I agree.
Fish what you're confident in and you're going to be successful. You got to go to the water with confidence to create confidence, you
absolutely.
Know, in my opinion.
So, yeah.
Well, guys, let's head to the water, and we're going to do a little bit of casting with Jim, and he's going to kind of show us how he fishes his sinking line and a few different techniques. So stick with us, and we'll be on the water here shortly.
What's up, everyone? The time has finally come to unveil the sneak peek of my brand new Alumawa Columbia 21-foot. Shout out to Stevens Marine. They're one of our partners with Addicted Now. They're sponsoring us. We can't say enough about how excited we are to be partnered with you guys, and I can't say enough about how excited I am to finally get my boat. This is Nelson here from Stevens Marine. We're gonna have him kind of run through just some of the base things of what I did with my boat, and then I'll jump in and show you guys some of the custom stuff that I did as well.
Yeah, awesome. So yeah, we started talking about this, what, last year, right in the middle of COVID
stuff.
So I mean, it took us a little while to work through the details of exactly how you wanted the boat. We had a lot of ideas of about things as far as improvements over previous boats you've had.
Yep.
So we got the 21-foot Alumawa Columbia here. Super versatile open platform, take it out in rough choppy water, down at the mouth of Columbia, crabbing out in the ocean, bottom fishing, salmon fishing, and go in 5 or 6 inches of water with a jet on it. So
again, for me, that was one of the major selling points. Everyone, the reason I wanted to get a Columbia so bad is just all the ones that I've ridden in, it's just like there's no other ride like it. So talk about like just sides, you know, width, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, so it's got an 82 inch wide bottom, so it cuts through the chop nice, but it's also stable. You're not out there rocking and rolling if you are in sort of a washing machine conditions. Tall, 33 inch tall side, so that's much higher than most open sleds, and that's part of what lends itself to being a nice dry ride. So
it's one of those another selling point for me. Like I love having higher sides on my boats.
It's so shocking when you're down there in like even, I mean, you get a straight crosswind, doesn't matter what you're in, you're gonna get wet. Mm-hmm. But I mean, it does a really good job of keeping you dry in a lot of conditions where in other open sleds, you know, you'd be in full rain gear and still probably soak through your rain gear. So,
let's walk around this thing and show them.
That's a big selling point. Another big selling point actually, which sort of often overlooked, is they come on the Rogue trailer, which is, you know, custom fit for this boat. It's built alongside a Alumweld, and they come with these vault hubs, which are a 10-year sealed non-serviceable hub. So I mean, it used to be hubs were a lot of maintenance. That was something that you needed to pay attention to, pretty much like a bearing buddy you need to pay attention to every time you take your boat out or every couple times. These, they're just like set it and forget it.
You shouldn't have to
worry about it. Yeah, we can look inside. Marlin ordered it with, you know,
I did diamond plate. I did both of the little storage trays in the side. We have the sink in the gunwale. I did a swim deck in the back, and we did rod lockers. We did electronics box. We're gonna have another box on the other side. We have lead trays. I did a garbage can inlaid into the floor, which I'm super excited about. Something I seen on Nick Popoff's boat, not a lot of boats have. What else, man? What else did we do here? I did all the chairs with all the armrests, nice chairs. I did a captain's chair. I wanted this boat to be fully decked out with all the things over the years that I've kind of learned as getting in other people's boats and having my own boats. I wanted it to just be like set up and ready to do every fishery that we have here in the Northwest. So over the next few weeks, guys, we're gonna keep kind of letting you updates and show you guys the build process, show when the motors get put on, talk more about those. And as each piece of the boat starts to come together, we're gonna bring you guys along for this journey. So make sure you guys subscribe, make sure you turn on the bell notification, and let's get back into the other video.
All right, so Jim's gonna show us where he thinks these fish are at, but you know, like we would usually fish this kind of on this seam. Like we, you know,
absolutely.
A lot of times these fish are gonna be just right on this seam where you kind of see this water churning, maybe resting right here before they're gonna come up this skinny chute.
I love the seam line.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it just tells you the travel lane and the resting and everything like that. So, you know, reading water and understanding it's a big part of fishing, no matter what kind of gear you're using, you know, fly fishing. I mean, if you know where they're at or you think, well, they should be there, it's a big advantage,
right?
You know, so I think in there is really good. So
you kind of still position yourself about a 45 to it?
You know, what I'll do is I'll usually cast like quartering upstream and then maybe straight out, and then I'll let it drift and swing. You know, the I want to work the water methodically, you know, like I'll start out shorter casts, then I'll go a little longer, and then, you know, then, and then you go out long, then you take a couple steps down.
So just
that's how you work a run.
Huh? Yeah, just gritting that water.
Yeah, you know, and that, and this is a long run, so I mean, it's almost endless.
Right.
You know, so it's really good. And what I wanted to show you first on this, is like a T300. You see right here where you go from the floating to the sinking, there's no knot, there's no splice, there's no hinging. It's all one piece.
Just going right through those guys.
Yeah,
that's
see,
great.
Like in the olden days, we always had to cut and splice them.
Right.
There's nothing else we could do.
Right.
And so this has really helped all of us to cast better, to be more productive.
Right.
And more, and you know, just to, that's why a lot of the guides and outfitters, you know, in different places, then we'll bring a teeny T200 or a T300 or, you know, things like that. So,
for an inexperienced guy who doesn't know this, back in the olden days when they started fly fishing, it was mostly floating line, correct?
Yes.
And so mm-hmm. until you came out with a line with the sinking tip, right?
Yes. Well, and you know what? When it gets really down to it, Howard West used to be in charge of scientific anglers. Mm-hmm. This was many years ago, and he came out and wanted to fish with me, you know, in Washington and Oregon. And so after we fished, and we, you know, I mean, we fished for I think 3 days, and we only caught maybe a couple fish. And he says, "Well, Jim," he says, "what do you think of our sinking lines?" And I says, "Well," I says, "they're really good. But if you want to fish our bigger rivers and our waters like this, you need a line that'll sink 2 to 3 times faster than your high D lines."
Right.
And so he went back and took it to heart and made the very first Deepwater Express shooting heads and sent them to me. I trimmed them down to what I wanted, and I tripled my fish hookups.
Wow. That's
incredible.
I mean, you know, because then I could cast and I could deliver.
Yeah.
And the only problem I had is that if I had a knot here, and if, you know how you get excited when you're fishing,
oh, yeah.
and if I ever pulled it in too far, then it, sometimes it get caught on your guides.
Hung up in the guides.
Yeah, right. Yeah, so then you gotta, you know, kind of shake it loose and everything.
And now you have this just perfectly just smooth
cable. Oh man, right, it's so, it's it. So, it's such an improvement. As to any of the loops and things like that, so.
Well, that's cool, and I'm excited to watch it in action.
Well, let me show you real quick. This line. So right at a point like this, where see where the orange is there within a foot or two.
Yes.
You can lift it up like this, then, and you can flip it like that, and you can roll cast it. So you don't even have to back cast.
Right.
I mean, in the roll casting in brushy, or you got a steep bank behind you, so you just pull it up like this, you need to have the line in the water, and then just shoot it back out. And that allows you to have more fishing time.
Right.
And so, and then also, this is not a tight loop, like a floating line, like when you're casting like that. So if you bring it back like this, you take the line, you get it to the surface, and you single false cast, and then you let it go. Just an easy.
Right. It's straight out.
They're so
right.
balanced.
Right.
I mean, they're honestly they're fishing machines.
Yeah.
You know, for cast.
You can really see that thing swinging through there right now too. You can tell it's down.
Yeah.
It is crazy how fast that thing.
You can really see it sink down and just.
See, so I'm holding the line here, and I don't keep my hand down here. I keep it like here. So when I go like this and I get it to the top, and then I hold it there, I'll come back. And then I can just kind of jerk it like that. See how you can just shoot it out?
Yeah,
I mean, that's a good cast with right. minimal effort.
Right. Yeah.
So, yeah, but the color change on all of them, whether it's a T130 or the T200, 300, 400, is the key is having that color change within a foot or two of your rod tip.
Right.
That's an automatic visual. That's where my
line
balance is. You know exactly where it's at. You're not guessing, well, I'm in too close or I have too much line out. Because see, for example, and this isn't gonna be a good example, but if you have like, you know, 6 or 8 feet of that orange out, you're not gonna be able to cast it.
Right.
Because you won't be able to pull it up out of the water.
Right.
So you have to bring it to the point like this, where then you hold this tight, you roll it to the surface, and if you want, you just go like this for a single false cast and you got it back out again.
Right back in that water.
Yeah, but that's the balance point of all of our T and TS series lines, is that color change by your rod tip. And they really have just opened up so many things that we can do now, fresh and salt water. And
I bet it's just changed the game.
Yeah, it's been really, really good. So,
perfect.
Well, I want to thank you guys for having me.
You bet. We really appreciate you coming out and spending a day with us out here.
It's a great day, and I'd like to do it again.
You're welcome anytime.
Put you out here for those fall Chinook, maybe. Oh. Get the big ones.
I would like that a lot. I'm actually a big king guy.
Right.
I love them.
I think we all like anything that swims, but the kings are one of my favorites as well.
But yeah, it definitely is, you know. So special to catch one swinging, you know, on a fly rod. I mean, you don't see it as much. I mean, definitely tougher than running gear.
It's even 100%. Today what I learned, you know, I learned a lot today because I'm not an experienced fly angler, and I admit that straight out of the gate, but I learned a ton today just watching you guys cast and how important it is to make that thing as natural as possible. You know, you can really, with spinning gear, you can really emulate that simple. You know, it's a lot easier. You have a float and weight and so on and so forth. Doing it this way is just, it's next level. So. You know,
sticking a string, right?
That's right.
See, I started with my dad, bait and lures and gear fishing and everything like that. And then when I was 12 years old, my good friend Jim Bagley, he showed me how to tie flies, and I started fly fishing. And I'm 75 now, and I'm still tying flies and still
flying.
Thank God for that, you know. And then I wanted to mention about the Hatchery Wild.
Yes.
It's a really great program.
Great program. Yeah.
And I just would be so excited to see a lot of people get into that, so that we can get more fish in a lot of our rivers. That's all it's going to take to get the people out on the water.
I agree. Yeah. The more fish we put in these rivers, whether, you know, our
broodstock program, it's, you know, it's great. It's speaking for itself.
Yeah, it's the driving force of our fisheries nowadays, and I think it's the most important thing. And I think it's the biggest misconception that, you know, everybody needs to get behind this, and it's a program we all can get behind, and hopefully you guys get behind it as well. Hatchery Wild, coexist. Look it up. We talk about it all the time. It's a super important program, and we want to thank you for coming out and sharing some tips and tricks with us. Addicts, Jim Teeny, thank you so much for coming, man.
All right,
Addicts, don't forget to hit that like, subscribe, turn on the bell notification, and we'll see you on the water.